The best thing to come out of Cats is the meme of all the horrible reviews and then cut to a bunch of dogs in front of computers with their paws on the keyboard. Right? This movie is a travesty. Can you believe who could believe that these cats are real?
Right.
Bowser 69.
They're just clicking at their keyboards and...
Well, I mean, anybody can be a movie reviewer these days, but these are some canine movie reviewers.
Yeah, they got their little headsets on and they're barking their reviews out.
What? Wait, where are movie reviewers doing it through headsets?
I don't know. I think maybe like,
is it like
they're typing
all
but maybe,
within a game of Fortnite or something?
They're typing, but maybe also they're like, you know, having their phone or their computer help them type a little bit too. Like I don't want to type this all out. All right. So they say
that specificity is the key to comedy, but not your kind of specificity.
Well, whatever.
Because you're like, but how do they type? They have the little pause. That's how I type.
Yeah. Right.
Two contact points.
Right.
Two middle fingers, which is very fitting. They couldn't just use their little pause and go click, click, clack, clack,
well,
clack.
Well, I'm suggesting that they do both.
But you're like, no, they need voice transcription.
Yeah.
Because a computer can understand barks.
Yes, exactly.
See how the detail falls apart?
Yeah, well, whatever.
Do you want to see Cats?
No, I do not.
What? Sorry, Oscar Isaac. I wasn't asking if you wanted to do another Star Wars. I was asking if you want to see Cats.
No, it's the stuff of nightmares. I have no desire to see it whatsoever.
But at some point,
talk about Uncanny Valley.
It passes over into Sudden Valley.
Yeah.
It passes over into entertainment, right?
I don't know if that's true or not. I just feel like I would be watching a car crash in motion and the entire time be wondering, why am I watching this? Why am I torturing myself?
The Room. So don't even get started with me.
It just looks so bad. I don't know that it's reached the point that it's so bad it's good. I don't know if it has.
There's bad. There's so bad it's good. And we talked about this, I think, last week, where there is soul and emotion in it.
Yeah.
Even if it's terrible. I don't know how I get sick. I guess I was traveling, so maybe I was coming into contact with people and their dogs.
Mm-hmm.
So that's why I'm sick. But like The Room. You know, like he meant all that.
Oh, yeah. Very earnest.
And then there's like bad that's just lazy and bad.
Yeah.
But then there's bad, like incomplete.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like you're not even, take this back, do it again. You're not going to get an A, even if it's great, because it's going to be late. But
right.
I can't accept this. It's not even done. And that is literally the Cats movie.
Right.
Recently, it was announced a day or two ago that the movie is being patched. Like a video game.
I just don't I don't understand.
We knew, well, I'm telling you right now, we knew we were in trouble when the director of the film was being interviewed, you know, a day or two before its release. And he was like, not bragging, but he was sort of like, well, that's so crazy. You know, I just got back from the editing bay. We were there for 36 hours straight. And we finished the movie hours before we hit the button, and movies are just distributed, you know, digitally now.
Right.
So you hit a button and it just goes to the server, and then theaters pull it down. Which is like, that's not something to brag about, dude.
No, it's not.
But anyway.
It's actually really scary and terrifying.
And that should have been the sort of flag, the red flag or the red laser pointer that tells you that this is going to be bad. Because now reviewers are not only saying, what is going on?
Yeah.
What's in this Slurpee? But they're also saying that it's literally not finished. Like, there are scenes where there's a group of cats, but then there's just like one person. Just like.
And why would there be a person where there's
cats?
Well,
I think it was a situation where, like, characters like the main characters have accoutrement. They have raincoats or hats or something. So there's one thing where they just forgot to add the cat parts to somebody. So there's just a guy standing there. And there's. Like, Judi Dench is in one scene, and she's got the cat makeup on her body, but they forgot one of her hands, and it's her left hand, she was wearing her wedding ring, so it's like, wait a minute, is Kukuru married or something?
Right.
There's just, like, textures that aren't finished, and some of the cats are blobby, and people were also saying, I'm an insane person now, but they were commenting on that. Well, that's all being patched out now. Because they were continuing. Tom Hooper must have went back to the lab and finished the rest of his homework. And now they are sending that out digitally. And It just reminds me of a scene from my life. First of all, I got a 5 on the English AP test, right. So don't come at me.
Yeah, yeah.
This show's called Just Enough Trope. But my AP teacher had this policy where you could turn a paper in as late as you wanted to.
Okay.
By a certain date, right?
Okay.
So if it was like the paper was due, quote unquote, Friday, you could turn it in at 11:59 on like Friday. Saturday night.
Oh.
You know, she would get up and go out to the Dropbox in her garage.
Yep.
And if the Dropbox is empty and the sign's closed or the door's locked, no paper. And my parents, my mother specifically, who was a teacher for like 50 years, I think,
yeah,
or close, yeah, hated that because it was, you know, assignments are in at a certain time. Now, that's all well and good. My mother meant well, but she had no idea what was coming. She didn't know that people would take classes online. Their textbooks, which they paid $200 for, wouldn't even be real.
Yeah.
And they would be emailing assignments. Yeah. She didn't know that.
Yeah.
She was just behind the times on that one.
Yeah.
So anyway, what I'm saying is I don't think it affected my tardiness or the promptness of me delivering assignments, this show coming out a day late, because we are gone for Christmas, notwithstanding. Hey, you're lucky you're getting one.
Yeah, right?
But this to me smacks of that. It's like, this is a movie, guy, and it doesn't matter if you can push a button an hour before it's supposed to premiere and people get it. This ain't done, man.
Yeah, yeah. And there should be no break.
And is it a lack of effort, or is it just... I admit having 20 dancers and they're all in body suits or leotards and you have to add fur to them. I get that that's an undertaking, but then why take it under?
Well, if you're not going to go all the way, don't do it. It's just.
That's our quote for 2019.
Right. I mean, it's slacking, you know, it's lacking a finishing touch. It seems like a rush job, and it seems like you didn't care, you know?
Yeah. Well,
like
anyway.
You didn't put the work into it.
Speaking of getting your homework in at the last minute, I mean, there's just a lot of... The movie business has changed very much.
That's true.
And, you look at the Golden Globes, and all the Golden Globe TV... Golden Globes or nominations are for streaming stuff. And
yes.
I'm sure the streaming movies are going to clean up at the Oscars this year. Probably. But yeah, it just this Tom Hooper is not, I don't think, anybody's idea of a great director. He directed the Les Mis musical at the beginning of the decade, and a lot of people didn't like that, although it did fairly well and got Anne Hathaway, made her dream come true.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, people questioned why this was made at all. People questioned why he's doing it. They questioned why it was done. Why not just have them wear costumes like the stage show has done for 40 years.
Honestly, this is just my opinion. I think it would have looked way better if they just did costumes. Because the costumes for the stage show, I think that they did a really good job. And yeah, they're kind of weird and stuff like that, but that's part of it. It's not like Uncanny Valley weird. It's just like they're human-sized cats and they walk around and they talk and they sing. And they dance. And I think that's, you know, part of the topness of the stage show. And I think that that could have easily been adopted for the film.
Well, and I think I can see why they did what they did. And I don't know if it was Hooper specifically, but why the production designers went, let's go all the way, because of that same thing. Because Cats doesn't really have a story to speak of. It is just sort of a collection of scenes and songs. But it is about spectacle. It's about watching Titus Andromedon and a bunch of people crawl around on all fours on poppers. Yeah. And they're trying to deliver that. But people just, their minds won't accept it. And that is, you know, I think earlier in the year I claimed that maybe we were cresting the Uncanny Valley and we were getting out of it. But not in this movie.
Well, I mean, we saw Sonic the Hedgehog and people were like, oh no, that's the stuff of nightmares. And they went back and they changed that. This comes out and we're like, oh my goodness, I don't know how I feel about this, but nothing has changed.
Yeah, I don't know. I think this will probably be, since it's coming so late in the year when all these lists are made of stuff, will be remembered as the year of like when the Uncanny Valley, you know, deepened a little or fought back. But it's really only those two things, right?
Yeah.
Well, Rogue One a couple years ago. Man, this whole decade was like, we're trying, man. We're trying real hard. James Dean is going to be in a movie. by himself. Right. It's a James Dean black box film.
I mean, I don't want to say if you held my a gun to my head, I'd go see this. I guess I would go see this.
People can't see that.
Yeah, all right. I guess I would. I would see it if you wanted me to see it, or if, if we went into it. Like,
it can't be as bad as people are saying.
I don't know. It's like one of those films. Like, I think I would go in and I think I'd be grumpy. I think I would be like really pissed off. And I'd be like pissed off holding my popcorn and being like, oh, this thing better start soon. It better be over soon.
Yes. I think you're thinking about Star Wars, The Rise of Skywalker, which we saw.
Yeah.
Of course, this weekend, and we have thoughts on, and we'll be giving them to you.
That's right.
Later in the show, so stick around for that. It's the Just Enough Trope podcast. I'm your host, Caliban, joined as always by my co-host.
Hi, I'm Megan Hanna.
And joined by the influenza virus, or whatever's going on.
Oh, boy. What is happening? How are you sick?
I don't know. Maybe I've got cat scratch fever.
Oh, boy.
18% on Rotten Tomatoes, 34 on Metacritic. So that I think that tells you that I don't think it's as bad as people say. People are saying that it's like the, you know, the beast, the Antichrist riding the beast with the Whore of Babylon on the side. And I think it's just not great, you know? But I think that we've had a lot of releases this year that I feel have been overvalued. Mm. I've talked about this before, about how critics wait for that real tomato can to come down the line that they can all like look left and right and agree, okay, we're going to savage this thing, right? And then mm-hmm. they can just let go when they watch Marriage Story and they go, some strong performances, but it's really just prosaic. We've seen this before. You know, sorry you got divorced, Noah Baumbach, but like, what are we really getting out of this except just emotional spectacle? But I liked it. Two thumbs up.
I know.
All 2 million thumbs up. All of our thumbs are up.
Right.
But maybe they've got frustrations and then Cats comes along and you can just give it to Cats.
Throwing a
boot at Cats.
I think it's definitely potentially a scapegoat.
Myself for the future. Hmm. Have a picture of Heathcliff singing on the fence and people throwing things at him, and I'm gonna tell my kids this was Cats.
Like Heathcliff, the cartoon cat?
Yeah.
Or okay.
He used to sing, and then he'd eat a fish. He put it in his mouth.
Yeah.
And pull it out.
Bones.
Just a skeleton.
Yeah, and I think.
But he'd leave the head.
Yeah.
That's the best part of the fish.
Well, I guess it wasn't for him. He just liked the middle part.
Yeah. If Heathcliff released in China, people would be like, "It's Heathcliff, not a smart cat." What's happening? So we're doing that. We're talking about some news. Do we have anything Christmas? Some of the news is Christmassy. I can't really think of any Christmas. Well, Merry Christmas, everybody.
Happy holidays.
We're here to bring you a holiday show full of festive cheer.
It's Christmas Eve, as some people say. So we'll go ahead and say that. it's approaching fast. And I don't know. Are we going to have a white Christmas here? I'm not sure if we will or not.
It's whitish already.
Is it whitish? Okay.
Well, I mean, it's white. Biologically.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well,
yeah.
Okay, cool.
Well, we got a ton of news. Let's get to it. This news, it's like tribbles. You leave it alone for a while with some grain. And we have so many stories to talk about.
Mm-hmm.
I need to like cut some holes in my net. I got to make my net larger.
Okay.
I mean, the holes in my net larger.
Oh, okay. So because we don't catch everything?
Yeah. I just got all this. I don't remember. We went through just total news deserts. Mm. Nothing.
Yeah. I think, you know, the end of the year, I think there's a lot of things coming out and there's like announcements and stuff like that. So
there sure is.
I think that people just want to get it in before the end of the year. Or maybe they're like thinking, happy holidays. Here's an announcement. I don't know. Here's our announcement gift to you. Blah, blah, blah. Here you go.
I appreciate you trying.
Yeah, you're welcome. Anyway. What are we talking about?
Should I talk about the news?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So I wanted to make something of a correction. We talked about the Xbox Series X.
Yes.
On the last episode.
Huge.
And the I think the branding or the messaging has been a little bit off.
Oh, okay.
Because Microsoft has clarified after the game developer conference or wherever the Game Awards mm-hmm. that the name of the new Xbox is just Xbox. Their internal name is Series X, but it's even more confusing now because it's just called Xbox.
Can they get somebody at Microsoft who's in charge of like naming stuff and is like actually good at it instead of like I don't I feel like we're doing like the names of like nesting dolls or something like that. Like each product is within.
I would buy that.
They're like,
you open it up, there's a little smaller Xbox. Oh, that's why it's so big. The real Xbox is inside.
Yeah. And it just takes like the what do you even call it? The little cards that you have for the Switch, like the little game cards.
Cartridges?
Well, they're
not cards now, wow. But yeah.
Okay. Searching for a word and it's right there. Anyways, terrible names and incredibly confusing. I don't feel like any other gaming system is this confusing.
Well, you could have a muddled and tortured succession of names or with numbers kind of attached to them. Or you could have what Nintendo has, which is just nonsense words that are really kind of off-putting.
Yeah, I guess.
Like a GameCube, that was probably the height for them, right? That uh-huh. said what it did what it said. You know what it is.
Yeah.
It's got a handle so you can carry it around like everybody does with their game console. But other than that,
I carry mine like a purse.
Yeah, right. Just throw it over there. So you've got that. But then you've got like the Wii. And people are like, what?
Yeah.
And then you had the Wii U.
How is the Wii U different from the Wii?
The Wii U is a portable console.
Oh, okay. All right.
Which, if it hadn't failed, it was their attempt to compete with the Vita, which really wasn't even... Handheld gaming,
yeah.
You have to remember that smartphones like put a stake through the heart of handheld gaming.
Oh, sure, because you can play lots of games on your phone.
But I think Nintendo took all the sort of research and development they put into the Wii U, which was a gigantic failure,
yeah.
And went, okay, what if we massage it and then make it the Switch?
Yeah.
Which is great name, great console.
I think that they really have come up with something really great with the Switch because it's so versatile. You know, you can play the games at home on your big screen or you can take them with you.
And they kept their commitment to hand physiognomy crushing control schemes.
Yeah.
The original NES is like, suffer children, square sharp edged controllers, two buttons.
Right.
Which I guess when you have like a meaty little kid hand is not so bad, but as an adult, forget about it. And then, like, the Wii's like, hey, shake this over your head, idiot.
Right.
And now the Switch is, like, a beautiful, great machine that looks fine when you're holding it outside of the dock.
Yes.
But then when you have to take the two little handles
right.
and hold them like Wii controllers.
For two players.
Or plug them into a thing that's way too small for an adult to hold.
Yes.
Or get, like, a third-party controller that, you know, has all the problems associated with third-party controllers.
Right.
You're never going to get through Overcooked. It's never going to happen.
It's... incredibly challenging.
Let's talk real fast about box office. We talked about Star Wars and we talked about Cats before, and I want you to guess which one is winning at the box office.
Star Wars.
I think you can. Yeah, Cats opened with a $6.5 million opening, which is not great. Honestly,
it's always hard for me to tell like what they're doing. Good.
They went up against Star Wars. They had only projected about 10 to 15, but it underperformed on that.
Yeah. You go up against Star Wars, even if you're way different and you have a way different audience, I think you're asking for diminishing returns.
Yes. Whereas Star Wars is doing great. I'm not sure that it's set any records. I know it's high. It made $176 million domestically.
Nothing to say
and
about.
$374 million globally.
Okay.
But I don't have my chart up with me. But I know that that's competitive, but I don't think that that's the biggest ever.
Probably not. It
made $90 million on Friday, which is
that's a lot.
Very, very, very big.
I have seen on my feed and Facebook that there are people who have already seen it more than once.
Oh, of course.
So, and I think that Star Wars fans are rabid like that. So I think multiple viewings will add to this. And I would not be surprised if it continues to stay number one at the box office for several weeks.
Well, not in China, though.
Oh, really? Well, they don't really like Star Wars.
No, we've talked about that before. No, it earned only $2.2 million adjusted for Western currency, up against IP Man or Ip Man.
Okay, that's probably number four, pretty big release
The finale, The Rise of Ip Man.
Yeah.
The last of those made $10.3 million.
Okay.
So, no, they both don't like Star Wars, and they love Donnie Yen.
Well,
which is same.
Yeah. Okay. Same. Well, I mean, I feel like you're a country where the original trilogy did not come out at the that time. Yeah. I just, it does not surprise me that they're just not that into it, and they're like, no, thank you.
Or I don't know how to say that in Chinese.
I don't know how to say that in Chinese either. But I know that it's
they're not saying ni hao to Star Wars.
Right. I know that it's more popular in Japan. I just saw somebody this was like several years ago, but they have like snow sculptures up in Hokkaido. And several years ago there was an artist that did some stormtroopers out of snow. And it was pretty cool, like giant stormtrooper heads and torsos and sort of thing. So it was pretty neat.
Neat.
Yeah.
Let's put a pause on movie news, although we've got a lot more, and talk about comic news for just a little bit.
Sure.
Looks like Spider-Woman is getting a new ongoing series.
Okay.
It'll be written by Carla Pacheco, who is not previously working for Marvel. Continuing in the tradition of Marvel. The thing that drives the MRAs crazy and the SJWs love, that they're going out and getting somebody outside the company who's from indie comics.
Okay.
Well, and I say,
think that's probably pretty good idea. Yeah,
why not? Sure. Yeah. Jerry Conway, Roy Thomas, Marv Wolfman, these guys are geniuses, but they created literally 75% of the Marvel Universe. Like, why not get somebody else?
Well, and I think that it's really important for comic companies to start moving more towards having female creators behind female character books.
Yeah, for sure.
Just representation is always a plus, I think.
Yes.
So.
That being said, those three guys I mentioned amongst many of the talented guys in the Marvel bullpen.
Yeah.
Had nothing else. They were motivated by hunger and creativity. Whereas somebody who went to, and I'm going to have to learn some more art schools.
Yeah.
So it doesn't sound like I'm picking on Cal Arts, but somebody who went to Cal Arts and really wants to be in comics and then is called up to the big leagues. You know, we've seen, you don't want to be the Andrew Luck of comic people.
Right.
Although Spider-Woman new ongoing, there's not a lot of pressure there. The reason I bring it up is she's getting a new costume redesign.
Oh, okay.
By Dave Johnson, by the, speaking of classic talents in comics.
Uh-huh.
And I don't like it. And I'm surprised that I don't like a Dave Johnson design.
Okay.
But she's had a tortured costume history over the years.
Sure.
And I'm going to show you some of her costumes now.
Okay.
Great pod. And we'll have to just relegate this to the show art, perhaps. We'll go left to right in what I'll assemble for the show art. But
okay, sounds good.
To look at her original costume. Now,
yeah.
The difference between what comic readers in the 70s saw and what you're going to see is these are all Spider-Woman costumes as portrayed by those really horny order sites.
Mm-hmm.
You're just going to see models from a Chinese website showing essentially fetish costumes for Spider-Woman.
Sure. So, okay.
Well, that's what comes up when I Google.
All right.
So Spider-Woman's original costume as portrayed here. This is it.
Okay.
Red and yellow.
Yep.
A sort of spider or like an insect abdomen sort of design.
Yeah.
High heels are, that's all fetish.
High heels? Because it's weird.
It's because, look, it's all latex.
Yeah.
And then the wings. She had underarm wings that was very
I'm familiar with that distinctive design. I thought that the wings were more like Spider-Man's costume. Maybe that came later with the webbing in it.
They are, but what are you going to do?
Yeah. Okay.
Now, you have to remember there's been a lot of Spider-Women over the course of the history of the character.
Different characters actually portraying her. Yeah.
So if you're looking at Maddie Jameson, the Spider-Girl of the Marvel Universe, she had essentially I think this is the correct one.
Okay, sure.
She had basically a Spider-Man costume. She was dressed like Spider-Man with a few little accents.
Yes, like female character accents.
What do you think?
I mean, it's fine. It just looks like we threw something together for a female Spider-Man, and this is it. So I'm not, like, terribly excited about it, but it's just, like, it's like his costume. So, yeah, it's fine.
Okay.
I don't think I like it as much as the first one. But.
Right. More than one woman has held the title of Spider-Woman.
Yes.
Over the years. One of the more recent ones was, of course, the Earth 3214 or whatever it's called.
Sure.
Version of Spider-Woman Gwen Stacy, also known as Spider-Woman. Yeah.
She's probably my favorite. I'm just going to go ahead and say it. I like this character. I like this story. I'm not as familiar with the original Spider-Woman as I am with Spider-Gwen. So I don't know, maybe I need to read some more Spider-Woman comics. But like the Spider-Gwen costume is like really cool. It's a lot of black and whites, but then she's got like these pink spider like accents. Like, and she's got pink outlining her eyes, and then she has this like really cool hood that's white and that's got like, it's like pink and then like spider webbing on the inside. And I think that looks really cool. And she often is wearing like turquoise, like all stars or slip on shoes too. I just think that her costume is really neat. And I think that they actually thought about it and made it something unique, yet also, you know, it has some elements that you would look at her and be like, oh, yeah, she's related to Spider-Man somehow.
Superman's got the spit curl, and then he puts his glasses on, and he's still got it, I think. So yeah, that's his problem. Batman's would have a big tan line under his nose and around his chin.
Yeah.
And Spider-Girl's just wearing the same blue jelly shoes.
Right.
Whether she's Spider-Gwen or Gwen Stacy, so... So much, yes, for your secret identity.
Yeah.
There was a Spider-Woman in the Ultimate Universe as well.
Okay,
and her costume,
sure,
looked like this.
That's pretty intense, I gotta say. It is definitely like a bodysuit. It's very form-fitting. But it's very dramatic, too. I kind of like that her hair is just kind of out and free-flowing. And then there's, like, it's mostly a red spandex suit, and she's got, like, this giant white spider all over her torso. And then giant white eyes, and the rest of the costume is just red.
Yeah, but don't, like, people were looking for a long brown-haired woman.
Yeah, okay, her hair could kind of give
That's
her away.
That's why Batgirl... Or best, well, yeah, Batgirl, and then also later the Greg Rucka Batwoman, they both wear wigs.
I see. Yeah, because like Batwoman has like this bright, fiery red hair, but it's a wig.
And I can't speak for the very earliest Barbara Gordon, but I know that like on the Batwoman or Batgirl TV show,
yeah,
she wore a, you know, it was Yvonne Craig with short black hair,
uh-huh,
sort of the time.
Sure.
And then she wore that like cheesy red wig.
Well, I think that that's kind of smart, and I don't know why like a lot of the female characters in Marvel haven't thought of that. Maybe they're not as good with secret identity stuff. I don't know.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Secret identities are kind of dead, huh?
Yeah, I think so.
Just ask Superman, who recently revealed to the world that he was Clark Kent, because...
Why?
Because Brian Bendis doesn't, he's so worried about if he could, he doesn't stop thinking if he should.
Yeah, well, he should think about if he should.
Here's one that you'll not find. There's no fetish model for this one. I'll have to show you a regular picture. This is Julia Carpenter as the Spider-Woman, okay, when Jessica Drew was retired and was just a PI.
Okay, this is very similar to the last one you showed me, except instead of it being largely red, it's mostly black. And then she's got the white spider on her torso, and then...
Black or some white boots and gloves.
Yes. And there's a cutout for her nose and mouth in the mask area.
I think Venom had a lot of influence on spider costumes post his debut.
Yeah, this they look like, very Venom-esque.
Yeah, definitely. This is Charlotte Witter, who is the, well, not as of the relaunch of the ongoing, but was also Spider-Woman for a time. She's the granddaughter of Madame Web.
Okay, well, her costume doesn't really scream spider to me that
No,
much.
But if you wanted to go fetish, this would be the way to go,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, yeah. You know what she reminds me of? What is the bad guy, the Enchantress? Isn't she like one of Thor's bad guys?
Yeah.
She kind of looks like she's Enchantress. It's basically a green swimsuit without the straps, and then there's like gloves, green gloves that are have yellow accents, and I think green boots that have yellow accents as well, and then like a mask cowl.
And yeah, and like bindings, like yes. rope. John Byrne, you got a girlfriend. Come on. what is all this? Yeah, so all of that leads more or less into... Oh, you know what? There's one more I should show you before we go.
Okay.
Cindy Moon, I think is her name, was Silk, the Spider Woman from an alternate universe.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And she has a costume that looks like this.
It's very Spider-Man-esque. It kind of reminds me of Spider-Gwen a little bit. There's a lot of black and white. And then most of her torso is like a spider web that's white at background with like red and black lines. And then, of course, she has the red mask that goes over her nose and mouth, which is supposed to conceal her identity.
I know. We're looking for an Asian woman with a ponytail.
I know.
Whether or not she has a mouth, unconfirmed.
Right. And I'm assuming that mouthpiece is silk.
Well, she probably spins it herself.
Right. So, gross. Yeah.
Gross. You're not in costume. Hold on. Okay, I'm good to go. Next up is the last redesign of Jessica Drew's costume. This was around the time of Secret War, and I believe Chris Anka designed this.
I think it's pretty slick.
This is the motorcycle outfit.
Yeah, I was just going to say, it looks like a motorcycle outfit. It looks like it's leather or pleather, and then she's got kind of a mask thing going on, but it could be just some really cool, like, glasses. That are red and yellow, and the outfit itself is largely black with like a red torso and kind of a spider looking thing on her torso, but it's very stylized. But yeah, I think it looks pretty cool.
Yeah, I think it's a part of the trend towards practicality.
Mm-hmm.
It reminded me a lot of Wonder Woman's like infamous pants.
Oh, yes. I know what you're talking about. When they redesigned her costume and they gave her pants instead of a short skirt.
When Jim Lee redesigned her costume.
Right.
And is like, belt, pouches? Jim, no. Okay.
Yeah, right.
Leather jacket? Sure. She's a friend to animals. She tricks them into coming close to her. And then she kills them and makes a jacket out of them. Well, anyway, here is the new Dave Johnson design.
Okay. Wow. All right.
Dave Johnson uses black the way JR shouldn't.
Okay.
I think he uses it to create like a solidity and then he accents and not just, it's all black.
Right. Well, I'm glad it's not.
But that
all
being
black.
Said, there's a lot of black here.
It's mostly black, though. It is a spandex suit. Which is mostly black with some red accents with black webbing on top, including the feet and the hands. And then they're like over the arms and the chest. It's just a spider web. And then there's like a spider just on her chest, not her whole torso. And then she's got like a mask attached showing her nose and her mouth.
Everybody knows who she is by now.
I know.
This this looks like a Black Widow costume to me. Are they?
It looks very Black
Widow. Are
they Widow.
Running
She's
into having too many spider related? Yeah, she doesn't have a belt at all.
Yeah. So she's like missing that. But yeah, I don't know. I mean, I don't hate it, but I actually think I like the most recent redesign, the motorcycle outfit, more than I like this.
Interesting.
Yeah.
I felt the motorcycle outfit was kind of busy.
It's a little busy.
And
but
sure, it's
I think
practical,
it's
but all the spider characters, you know, are they wield their agility as, you know, one of their, you know, offensive and defensive abilities. And
oh,
so,
yeah, for sure.
Yeah, people like Frik joke and abuse how they look in their costumes, but they're supposed to, you know, it just feels like having leathers on would slow you down. But
yeah.
This is, you know, like I said, I mean, it's fine. But putting like web on the bottom of the foot where nobody's going to see it. I sense?
Right.
I sense a great artist backed into a corner. I sense a great artist trapped in a web of 47 previous Spider-Woman designs.
Right.
What do I do to make this interesting?
And memorable.
So this is what we got.
Yeah. Okay. I mean, I don't hate it, but I don't love it. So.
Yeah.
Well,
you know what Marvel fans hated and didn't love?
What?
The fact that some of them couldn't watch the tribute to Stan Lee
yes.
that aired on ABC.
Yes.
This last Thursday night.
And we're lucky. Friday night? I think it was Thursday.
Yeah.
Or was it Friday? Anyways, it was one of the 2 days. And we were really lucky. We were able to see it.
Were we lucky? Let's review it. Go.
Well, I guess I was a little surprised at like the actors they got to come in and introduce and host things. And some of them I'm like, why are you doing this? And you suggested that maybe they were still under contract and stuff like that. So Clark Gregg was kind of hosting the entire thing, which I was fine with, but they like pulled in a lot of other people, and like they had Paul Bettany like talking about stuff, and then they had what's her name from Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. as well, Ming-Na Wen. Thank you. And for some reason, Clark Gregg came out to introduce her, but nobody came out to introduce Paul Bettany. And I'm like, is she more famous than Paul Bettany?
Yeah.
And I feel kind of bad for Paul Bettany.
Well.
And then they, like the actress who plays Karen in Daredevil, she didn't get introduced either. Did she?
Yeah.
Was it Paul Bettany the only one who didn't get introduced?
Possibly. Maybe it happened before they came back from commercial. I don't know. The whole thing to me seemed superfluous.
Yeah.
Not in terms of, you know what it really was, or the real value of it was?
What?
I'm imagining this was happening in 500,000 other homes, but they would do something, or they'd say something about Stan Lee, and my folks were watching just out of like just rank curiosity.
Yeah.
But they would say something, and then I would go, actually, he did this, and they forgot to mention that he did that. And then they would go, yes. Oh, that's interesting. Like, who wrote? The whole thing seemed rushed. Yeah. I'm assuming it was an hour.
I think it was about an hour. Yeah.
Yeah, there was enough commercials. It must have been an hour. And it just seemed like a lot of stuff we already knew, not digging into the really interesting parts of his life, totally giving – he from the 70s on became like his own PR person.
And oh,
he
for sure.
Had told these stories. I was at a party, and if I could be a fly on the wall, but nobody wants Fly Man, so it's Spider-Man.
Right.
Like, he told these stories a million times, and they just basically went with his version of it. And I didn't expect them to come out and, like, do a warts and all thing, but you think that they would find,
but...
like, they talked to his brother, they talked to the Jerry Conways, for instance, people that are still alive. They had a grainy video of Steve Ditko shooting a shotgun at them. No. but I just figured, like, we'd get something new. It was just them coming out and going, Stan Lee was so amazing, and we owe everything to him. And it's just real blowjobby. And then they just said Jack Kirby's name once.
I know. I think that it was... I'm just thinking back of, like, all the...
Boy, our Star Wars review is going to be real short because this news is going on.
Well, forever. I was just thinking about how, like, the different comic documentaries that we've seen. And I feel like those covered more of the gamut of, like, the actual story and what happened. Like, yeah, these amazing things happened, but also these things that were not so great kind of happened. And that didn't really happen in this... quote-unquote documentary, and it was just a, like you said, it was like just a love fest.
It could have been, if they put all this money behind it, they did it for, you know, they did it for primetime review views and commercials, and they also did it to, because it's been a year, like they did it to just say, well, we finally did it.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm sure it was nice, and I'm sure it would have been great to be there, but if they took the money of the Disney Corporation and put it behind talking to all these people, and we got like a two-hour documentary...
Right.
Talking to, that's, look, it was great to see Charlie Cox. I don't know why we're talking to him, because he's not part of this anymore.
Well,
do you know what I mean?
I don't know why.
He's the fourth Destiny's Child member.
Yeah, I know.
But it was great to talk to him. But also in a 42, maybe 35 minutes worth of content amongst all these commercials, we don't need to talk to him.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you need to talk more to Louise Simonson.
Yes.
Who right. I was happy to see.
Yes.
Chris Claremont's probably like, no thanks. But yeah, I would have loved to have seen a 2-hour produced documentary, including all this material and all the people they must have talked to.
Right. Well, yeah. And then, of course, Tom Hiddleston shows up, and he had like probably the largest introduction of all of them, which is fine. But I was just like, gosh, you don't need to do this. Why are you doing this?
Because he's got a TV show coming up.
I guess.
Stop.
Okay.
So thumbs to the side.
Mm-hmm.
Thumbs. Holding down the middle two fingers while the pinky and the index finger are splayed out.
Yes.
To create
webbing.
A costume for myself.
Oh, okay.
I wanted to report something sad from the world of film, specifically French film.
Okay.
And French film from the 50s and 60s. The actress Claudine Auger has passed away. Passed away last week. She's probably best known for her role as Domino in the James Bond film Thunderball.
Okay.
And she also was a runner-up in the 1958 Miss World contest.
Okay.
She was in a lot of kind of, you know, a lot of experimental kind of weird movies. This might have been, it's basically like the French New Wave sort of era. She was in The Testament of Orpheus, which is a Jean Cocteau film.
Okay.
Which was sort of like a exploratory early French New Wave type film. And yeah, was also just was a really nice person.
Mm-hmm. Sure.
And for my money, like the most beautiful Bond girl, or at least top five for what that's worth.
Sure. Well, it's sad to hear that she's passed. How old was she?
She was 79.
Okay, that's
or 78. Excuse me.
I still feel like if you pass in your 70s, I still feel like you're fairly young.
Yeah.
So that's too bad.
And she was, at least for the Bond film, which really kind of catapulted her to stardom, she was discovered by by dark black sheep Bond producer Kevin McClory, who basically just saw her, you know, in Nassau, like saw her on the beach. It was like, she should be in this film.
Okay.
And so she was in the film, which is how they kind of did things back then.
Sure.
But yeah, she had a long career after that. And then probably even more sadly from an artistic perspective, we lost Anna Karina recently.
Okay, sure.
Who, I hate when I hear that somebody has died and I wasn't sure that they were alive or not.
Oh, yeah. Then you just kind of feel extra
I feel bad, yeah. She hadn't done much acting since like the 80s.
Sure.
But she was in many of the seminal New Wave films by Jean-Luc Godard.
Sure.
Who was married to her until 1965. Films like A Woman is a Woman, and Band Apart, and Pierre Le Fou, and Alphaville, which is, I love Godard films, but it's also like a sci-fi film.
Oh, okay.
And so, yeah, that's probably my favorite Godard film, because it unites my two, French New Wave and sci-fi, my two great loves.
Sure.
And yeah, just a wonderful person. It was a musician and I think got out of here without saying anything real dumb.
Okay, it's fair. There's I understand a lot of French.
She was actually not originally French. She was Danish, but she was Danish French citizen.
Sure.
And yeah, got out of here without pulling a Gainsbourg or
good
pulling
good.
A. You know what I mean?
I know what you mean. Let's open mouth, insert foot. I'm glad she didn't have a moment like that.
Yeah. So. Didn't pull a Catherine. Didn't Catherine Deneuve say something dumb recently?
Oh, I have no idea. Probably.
Yeah. Live your truth. Yeah. Especially if it's, you know, what do you call it?
I don't know.
When you hate people from the outside of your country.
Oh,
xenophobic.
Yeah. Xenophobic, yeah.
Go for
it.
Yeah,
wow.
Awesome.
Okay.
So this episode, insofar as it can be, because I don't think they gave a shit about Star Wars, is dedicated to them. Another D word we're looking for is the debut of a couple trailers.
Oh, yeah.
That's a lot of news.
Yeah, I know.
That's a lot of news. Let's talk real fast about Tenet.
It looks really good. I mean, as much as you can just give like a tease as to what a movie is going to be about.
Yes.
It, and I didn't see Christopher Nolan's last movie that was like a war film, but this seems kind of like a return to form. Like, I mean, as much as like a sci-fi return, it could be.
I think there's a lot on the line.
Yeah. And
for him.
I think so too. And
because... Oh, we'll just say
it. Oh, okay. I think that they put a really enticing trailer together. And there's lots of little bits that you just kind of get a glimpse of. And it's like, ooh, what's that? I want to know more about that. And the lead actor,
John David Washington.
Yeah, is apparently Denzel Washington's son. So that's kind of cool too. And like Robert Pattinson is also in this, but like,
and he must have gave him his agent, because Robert Pattinson's in this and he's not even billed in the trailer.
No. So yeah, so I that's kind of interesting to me as well.
So but... yeah, this is gonna be a real coming out party for John David Washington.
Yeah, for sure.
So yeah, looking forward to that. But I just think that the stakes are high because this ain't Batman, you know what I mean? I mean, Dunkirk did fine. Yeah. People liked it. Interstellar, I think, was, you know, mixed.
Yes.
But generally seen as a success. But, mm-hmm. you know, where are we going from here? Are you going to do Love is the Strongest Force in the Universe? Or are we doing, you know, action with a little bit of intellectualism, but not as much as you'd think?
Uh-huh.
And that's, I think, what this is going to be.
Okay.
And that's fine. That's what I want from him.
Yeah, right. I want to see new things, different worlds being explored and everything. And I think we're going to get that.
I want to explore the rest of this news, and let's do it in like 5 minutes.
Okay.
Ready? Go. They're remaking The Dirty Dozen.
How do you feel about that?
Guess who's directing it? David Ayer. Yeah, that's right. Okay. David Ayer.
Wow. All right.
David Ayer just wants to be the Steven Spielberg of war movies now.
Doesn't everybody?
All of his war movies are not very good.
Okay, well.
What else? Looks like Lucasfilm is developing a Willow TV series. We've heard this before.
I don't know if I should believe this or not. Is it going to be on Disney Plus?
It is.
Okay.
No,
well,
no, it's not.
Oh, it's not.
We don't know where it's going to distribute just yet.
Okay, well, maybe it'll actually happen this time. I don't know. I feel like we've had rumors of this before in the past. I mean,
there's a Witcher show.
Yeah, I know.
There's going to be a Willow show.
Okay. I'll have a review of The Witcher next week. I'm assuming he's going to...
Yeah, he's around. He's in Star Wars.
I know.
We got to get to that. Forget all. This is all garbage. I feel like Adam Driver.
Oh, boy. You're just going to get up and leave?
Okay, so a lot of people are like, well, not really. I don't think people really care because nobody knows who Terry Gross is. But Adam Driver was on Fresh Air. Apparently, Adam Driver doesn't like to see himself act or hear himself act.
Yeah.
Yes, but also you are on my show. I'm Terry Gross. This is Fresh Air.
Right.
And so they have a thing. He has a thing that must be in his rider. Did you want to be this person, Adam? Will you join the Marines to serve your country? So anyway... He has a thing where they let him know, he takes his headphones off. We as the audience hear the bit, although why can't you just put the bit in post? Does Fresh
Air? That's what I was wondering.
I guess Fresh Air goes off live. I don't know. I don't listen to WBEZ or whatever. But they did, I think they did it, right? They played the bit. He took his headphones off, but then she went back to him.
Away.
Because he's not there, of course. She's in Chicago. He's in in Hollywood. And she's like, so tell me, Adam, about the thing of the thing. Adam.
Yeah, and they had to tell her that he was gone.
He walked out.
Yeah. Yeah.
What?
I know.
I think everybody's stressed.
Uh-huh.
And I said this in previous weeks, and then I showed you video evidence recently.
Yes.
Where somebody asked, you know, Daisy Ridley and Oscar Isaac, if they were any interest in coming back to these characters. Oscar Isaac's like, no!
I know!
Not adding the F word in front of it, but he wanted to.
Yeah.
I think that Adam Driver's just done. He doesn't care. He's frustrated. He's got to go to this premiere. He hates premieres.
Yeah, yeah.
But don't take it out on Terry Gross.
I know, right?
She's like Real
the
Yoda.
She's the nicest lady ever.
she's Lady Yoda. We got Baby Yoda. We got Lady Yoda.
Yeah, I know.
And so, yeah, don't take it out on her. And then also I was watching an interview all the stars are being interviewed at Galaxy's Edge about the thing. And as soon as they got to like, well, thanks, everybody. Like Oscar Isaac was halfway out of his chair. He ripped his lav mic off. And then as the other stars were like, so where are we going next? Or are we done now? And he's just like, see ya, buddy, to like JJ. And he just runs off the grid. Where's he going?
Oh, my God.
He doesn't have something else to do. But he's just, he is done. Professionally, he is done. If you're going to be a guy that, you know, sings and plays the guitar and does HBO miniseries and does movies and you're probably, he's married, right?
I don't know, probably.
Well, maybe he is, maybe he's not. I think Oscar Isaac is a guy that regiments his time and he does it because of where he wants to get in his career. And he has decided, no more time goes into Star Wars.
This is a dead end.
I fulfill my contract and I'm not hanging around.
Right. I guess it's the difference
between him. Yeah, it's the difference between like tell a boring story or blow my nose.
Blow your nose, I guess.
Why not both? Okay. I got to learn how to say that in Spanish. When I was in professional theater, like, and I was new to it, you come from community theater or from, like, school theater, and everybody does it for the acting, but they also do it because that's their social and their peer group, right?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So you hang out when we're going to Baker Square or whatever.
Right.
And everybody's hanging out all the time. And I tried to do that with some, you know, some of the other younger, like, people that were new to professional theater did that. Mm-hmm. But pretty much everybody else, all the diehards are like, bye, and they're just gone. Because they got life, they got families, they got a fresh airs on, whatever. Right. And I'm not saying that that's what he's doing, but it, I mean, that's...
It feels like much, that's what he's doing. Yeah. Right. He's, like, they're all going to go out to lunch
somewhere. Yeah, John Boyega's probably really sad that Oscar ran off at the end of that thing. Right, but Oscar's like, I'm done with this now.
Yeah. Bye-bye.
Yeah, we're done. What else? Looks like Lodge 49, dead.
Really?
Yep, over.
Okay. Well, I mean, it kind of went off the rails this last season, so I can't say that I'm, like, super surprised.
I think that the creator who confirmed this on Twitter or whatever, he went on, like, a long, not rant, but, like, you know, don't stop me, Smee. Don't stop me. Right. You better get up here and stop me, Smee.
Right.
Yeah, he basically said, yeah, it's pretty much done. Jim Gavin is the guy's name.
Okay.
So I think that he knew, and that's why the second season seems so packed with all
lots
payoffs.
Of stuff. Oh, yeah. I see. So you think he knew before.
Do you want to tell the story of Roller Skate Hooker?
I believe Linda Ronstadt, correct? Yes.
Being honored at the Kennedy.
She was being Awards. Honored at the Kennedy Awards, Lifetime Achievement Award, that sort of thing. And somebody had put the slideshow together, and there is a cover of an album that probably came out in either the 70s or the 80s. And she is in roller skates and shorts and maybe like a cutoff, like sleeveless shirt.
It's like,
and she's got like knee-high socks on.
Good time, Charlie. Or something. I can't remember the name of the album is.
Yeah, but... somebody putting this together, I don't know if they just found it and they didn't like look at it.
They clearly just went Google search for album name.
Right.
First a pick of the album cover, throw it up.
Yes.
But someone else had memed it a little and written like, replaced the title with Roller Skate Hooker.
I know. So she's being honored. And they do this like slideshow or whatever, and then it's like Roller Skate Hooker. It's like... Come on. Who is asleep at the wheel here?
Oh,
you know?
So good.
I think she actually probably had a good sense of humor about it.
Oh, yeah.
She's a pretty vocal like person.
Yeah.
But yeah. So
so great.
Wow.
Oh, I love it. what else? In a move that should surprise no one, He-Man and the Masters of the Universe is getting a cartoon at Netflix.
Okay.
I know that we are still talking about this live-action movie that may or may not happen, but in the meantime, with the success of She-Ra,
sure.
Yeah, they're just going to do Netflix. He-Man? Okay. That makes sense, I think.
That makes sense.
It looks like we have cast a young Galadriel for the Lord of the Rings series.
Okay.
Now, forgive me. I believe that this is Welsh, so I'm not sure if I'm going to get this right, but it's Morfydd Clark.
Okay.
Is the young actress that they are getting. I am not very familiar with her, but she did play, I know, the nurse.
Yes.
In the, who's taking care of the stolen children in the His Dark Materials series on BBC HBO.
Right.
So we got that going on.
Yep.
What else? Viacom CBS has, I don't think it's gone through yet, but they have cut a $375 million deal for a 49% stake in the Miramax catalog.
Oh, boy.
Quick recap. After Harvey Weinstein was arrested and put on trial, and his brother basically just sold off, like, the business.
Mm-hmm.
So Miramax, one of the... Which was owned by Disney for a time.
Sure.
One of the biggest, quote-unquote, indie studios in Hollywood with a huge catalog of films, basically went on the chopping block or the auction block, either or. And nobody seems to want it for some reason.
That's too bad.
I mean, $375 million doesn't seem very rich.
No.
Blooded, right?
No.
Some movies
not
are made
for that.
Not in
the grand scheme of things.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So anyway, Viacom CBS, basically the parent company of CBS, Paramount, has bought it.
Okay.
And will apparently or theoretically get distribution, digital and physical distribution rights.
Okay.
And then I guess rights to whatever... Like IP, mm-hmm. would be there. So I don't think you could like do Kill Bill 3 without Quentin Tarantino's permission.
Right.
But anything in, that Miramax produced that they own the rights to, Paramount would get.
Okay.
How is this a bad deal? Because it's Paramount we're talking about here.
Yeah.
They can never not screw something up. Right. So I'm trying to figure out how they've screwed this up. I know that having 49% is not great. What's happening here is as soon as Miramax went on the auction block, a foreign investor, I think he was an Arab oil guy,
sure,
and a Saudi Arabian guy, bought the catalog for X amount of dollars. Not to just sit on it, because what's he going to do with it? But he then wanted to shop it to somebody like Paramount. And so he has a controlling 51% interest in it.
Okay.
And Paramount's got a 49%.
Yeah, that's not great.
Well, I mean, he's not going to give it all away. Otherwise, he'd sell the whole thing, right?
Right.
And Paramount couldn't afford that. Mm-hmm. That would be $700 million, $1 billion. Yeah. So I don't know. News to come.
Yeah.
When they screw it up, we'll be here to report on it. And maybe one or two more stories here. It looks like Disney, in this Verge article, is reporting that Disney produced 80% of the top box office hits this year.
I can believe that. There's a lot of films that they put out this year.
Yes.
And most of them have done very well. So, yeah, I can totally get that. Disney is a mammoth, you know?
Yeah, but I'm not ready to agree with Martin Scorsese just yet.
Oh, no. I'm not either.
Do you think he pitched it to a Disney subsidiary?
Subsidiary?
Irishman? Yeah. And then they were like, no, I don't think so. And he's like, oh, I'm ready to go. Marvel's
going to hate them. Maybe, but I feel like it's too adult for like Disney. Like maybe they would, if they wanted it, maybe they
would. But Disney controls so much. I'm not going to look. Well, I mean, Fox, you know?
Yeah.
I'm not going to look it up right now, but there's some Hollywood Pictures or Buena Vista Pictures, Touchstone type thing, right?
Yeah, that's true.
Who even knows? I guess they own too much when you don't even know what they own anymore.
Yeah, they are. Wait.
And in the last story of this round, but probably the best news, it looks like Melissa F. Olson's series of books, Dead Spots series, the Old World series, is being developed for a television adaptation on the upcoming digital network Quibi.
Yeah, I don't know a lot about Quibi, but I think this is really exciting. I think that her series would lend itself well to TV. I mean, she's basically a paranormal detective, you know, the main character.
Like a janitor.
Well, yeah, she cleans up the messes, but she doesn't just clean them up. She also tries to get to the bottom of, like, what happened and who did it.
She's a PI without being a PI, necessarily.
Right.
Yeah.
She's like a PI / cleaner. Yeah.
Yeah. A janitor.
Yeah.
You got it.
Exactly. Yeah.
It's being produced by a couple different people. One of them is Jen Braden. She has worked on a lot of kind of different stuff. That's great, right?
Yeah.
She's a writer-producer who's worked on shows like Awkward, Girl Boss, which I guess has a you know Girl Boss, right?
I think I've heard of it before.
It was only one season, I think, but it was Britt Robertson, and it was like I think streaming.
Sure.
And she worked on The United States of Tara. So it seems like this is one of those things where it's like your content is going to get to prove itself, and then the writing and producing staff are going to get to prove themselves too.
Right.
So it's not like Ryan Murphy's doing this. It's not like that.
Right. But I'm looking forward to seeing it, and I hope that they do a good job.
Oh, and I should also say that she's the co-executive producer on the Disney Plus series Love, Simon. So
there you go.
I have a question for you,
Nicole
Hanna, the co-host of this show.
Yes.
Do you have the golden touch?
Me?
Yes.
That would be cool.
We just mentioned two properties created by two friends of yours.
I know.
And would you look at this manuscript that I've got?
Yes and yes. I'd like to think that I have a golden touch, but I don't know. I'm very excited and happy for my friends who are authors and them getting deals and getting to produce on these projects as well, which is huge.
Yeah. It's great news, and congratulations to Melissa. Yes. And we wish her the best of luck, and I look forward to finding out what Queeby is.
Yes, me too.
It's funny that they would, I guess this is probably, I feel like Dead Spots is the safe bet, because feel like, you know, I don't think that it's derivative, but I think that we've seen like what it does before, you know, in a, you know, World of Darkness, Vampire Diaries, True Blood-esque kind of way.
Yeah.
But I'd almost be more interested to see the Boundary series become a thing, because I think that that's, there's a lot in there that's, we haven't seen before.
That's
and there's
true.
A lot there that is, now I'm going to compare it to something else that doesn't seem original,
okay.
But there it's more Stump Town-y. You know, you've got this like haunted, you know, combat vet who comes back and then has to deal with all this noir-y crap.
Yeah, no, that's
only with
really,
ghosts.
Right. Yeah. That's a very good way of putting it. And
but, you know, Dead Spots makes it.
Yeah. See that boundary. Exactly.
Cross that boundary when we come to it.
Yeah.
Great, it starts with an earthquake, birds and snakes, an airplane. Lenny Bruce is not afraid. I have a hurricane, listen to yourself, turn worlds of its own.
The dead speak.
Yes.
And they say, don't make any more Star Wars movies.
Right.
No matter what happens, no matter what Star Wars does to me, give me that Baby Yoda doll. I'll show you where it happened. When the theater goes dark and that blast of horns comes on, I get goosebumps every time.
Yeah, I know what you're
except saying. Except this time.
Oh, really?
Yep.
Okay. It didn't happen for you this time.
Much like J.J. Abrams, much like Oscar Isaac, and presumably and apparently everybody who worked on Episode 9.
Yeah.
You're done. Ready to be done with Star Wars.
Okay.
And that's going to be the main thrust of my review all the way through this.
Okay.
You?
I liked it.
No, where are you going?
what do you want?
Give me the pull quote. Give me the touch before we do the plunge.
Just like
these are all industry terms. I didn't make that up.
My knee-jerk reaction to the film?
No. Just tell us what happens in the movie.
Oh, okay. All right.
Come on. Stay light on your feet.
So, like,
this led into a 2.5-hour movie.
All right. There's an opening crawl in which we learn that Emperor Palpatine is still alive.
No, there's a Fortnite level where we learn what happened.
Yeah, which I don't know.
I'm glad I didn't know that going in.
Yeah. Apparently.
As the movie opens.
Yeah.
We hear the dead speak. There's a transmission that Palpatine has sent out. I am still alive.
Right.
I rise. Or whatever. And you go, that would have been interesting to see.
Yeah.
But when you think about it, the opening crawls have always filled us in on stuff. Like the Attack of the Clones ends and it's like, this is going to be a tough war. And Return of the Jedi or Revenge of the Sith opens with, the war was tough. You yada yada'd the war.
Yeah, we
and
didn't
I know
see
that,
a war at
I
all.
Know that there's a series, but at the same time, like, we're at the end of the war.
Yeah.
So, I mean, it didn't bother me. I can take that for granted. But then I found out, no, you get to see his transmission if you play Fortnite.
Yeah, which is ridiculous.
And then I got
to me.
Really, really mad.
Yeah.
But go ahead.
And then it just talks about, like, what else is happening with Resistance, where General Organa, like, Leia is, and Daisy Ridley, who plays Rey, is like training to become a better Jedi. We basically open with
is a phrase that says that you still don't get how to summarize a film. You're going scene by scene, and I have to take over every time.
I'm just saying, you open an Oscar.
Palpatine, the Emperor who died in Star Wars, Return of the Jedi, Episode 6, is somehow back. Mm-hmm. And he speaks. And he presents a threat to the galaxy that our heroes, our belabored heroes, and our fledgling Jedi Rey must risk everything to stop.
Mm-hmm.
Speaking stops, full stop. Done. That's it. That's what happens in the movie.
All right, fine.
Are you mad?
A little bit.
The structure is the same every single time.
Yeah.
We can't spoil anything.
Yeah.
Everything past the pan down through the starfield to whatever dumb planet we're on is a spoiler, right?
Yeah.
Because you can read the crawl online and you can read, like, the every review tells you the shot of the movie, but they don't tell you about Babu Frik.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And they should.
Uh-huh.
Because it covers a lot of sins.
Okay.
Babu Frik repaired for our sins.
Uh-huh.
Or whatever he does.
Yeah.
What does he do?
He works with droids. He's like a droid mechanic.
Yeah, right.
But he's little and cute, so, you know.
Yeah. Take that, Baby Yoda.
Yeah, I know.
Put something in the back of your head.
Okay, wow.
But
wow.
What do you think of this stupid film?
I still love Baby Yoda. I liked it overall, but there were parts of it that I didn't like.
This movie made me sick.
Okay, wow, calm down. and maybe this is me picking up on, like, hearing other people's reviews, but it was a lot of, we gotta go to this place, and we gotta do this thing, and we gotta find this object. Oh no, we need to find this object, and now we need to do this thing. And then, like,
it was a Sunday circular of plot coupons.
Yeah. And then, like,
I wasn't celebrating. I needed to actually sniff that.
I understand.
That was my celebration sniff.
Like, there would be moments of you know, like, things like, wow, that's really tragic. And then it would be, like, taken back, like, almost instantly. You know, because we thought maybe a character died, but then it was, like, shown that they were still alive.
In your quest to quote other people's reviews, you will go into spoiler territory. Tell me what Mikan Hanna thought about the movie. All you have is your own experiences. And apparently the reviews of many other people that you're desperate to quote. How'd you feel going in? How'd you feel watching it? How do you feel now that you've seen it?
I wasn't sure.
Empty.
I was not sure how to feel going into the movie. I was not very confident that J.J. Abrams would come to a good end, because even he himself was like, I'm not good at endings. It's just like, I don't want to hear that from the guy who's directing the last Star Wars movie in this
trilogy. Also love when he says, some people hated this film, and he's like, they're right. The people who loved it are right. The people who hated it are right. It's like, that is just the agree with the bully advice. Junior high, the bully's like, yeah, you stink. You know, you just tell, yeah, you know what? Oh, boy, I sure do. You got me there, Chet.
Yeah.
I'm not working anything out here.
I don't know.
It doesn't tell me anything.
No.
About the pride that you have in this. Everybody's done. We're all done. Everybody is done. They want to get out of this.
Yeah.
The guy that sculpted Babu Frik was probably angrily throwing his, like, tools down. Like, I think everybody is just done and wants to be done with this.
Yeah, I agree.
And I don't know why they couldn't have seen that coming when they started developing this, or when they developed the first one. Like, look, we've got this opportunity. The guy that effed up Star Trek can now eff up Star Wars. But I got to tell you, people aren't going to want to do this forever.
Right.
So we need to do 1, 2, 3. What do? We introduce a girl. She's mysterious. She's going to climb a mountain. And she's going to come down the mountain. And we're going to end. No, we hired 3 filmmakers, one of whom has a proven track record of success, and 2 complete yokels.
Yeah.
And they're not going to talk to each other.
No. Nope.
And as much as people complain about this movie completely retroactively retconning 8, that's what 8 was to 7.
I agree.
Everything that it's like we were talking about this before. It's an improv game. It's a game of, like, storyteller, right? So I say, once upon a time, there was a man who lived in a house and he
died.
Thanks, Ryan Johnson.
Right, exactly.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So I go, in his heart, when his girlfriend left him, but then they got married, but then they ran away from the altar, and then I got to cram all this stuff together to somehow make this
make it work.
End.
Yeah.
And also bring the close to 24 character arcs.
I know.
There really isn't anything else that we can really say without talking about the end of 24 character arcs.
Yeah.
So just give me the huge, like, recommend maybe 1 good non-spoiler observation, and we're out.
Okay. I would recommend it. I think that it ends on a high note. And a feeling of hope and positivity, which I think should be at the heart of Star Wars. So,
what review was that from?
That was just me. Wow, thanks.
Meek on Hana, 2019, bitch. This comes from a guy who does not generally enjoy J.J. Abrams films, who feels like they are just flashy and loud and dumb. It's just a fun movie. Mm-hmm. I imagine that this is how Fast and the Furious fans feel when they see Fast 7 or something like that. I don't know anything about Fast and Furious. I was watching it cognizant of the fact that it's just completely empty. But at the same time, I wonder, how can you... You gave yourself this dumb task of somehow summarizing and bringing to a close 45 years of fans' love for something. And so if you want to do that in like the... It's like the Stan Lee tribute. It's like everybody's smiling. A couple famous people are there. What a great guy. The end.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And if you walk away empty, you're thinking about it too hard.
Mm-hmm.
That's me.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, Babu. Yes. Give me them. Get into them guts. Get into them 3PO guts. Give us the answers. Spoilers.
Yes.
Those white slavers did it. They did it. They landed this thing.
White
right,
slavers?
Right, George?
Wow.
I sold it to the white slavers.
Oh,
Disney.
My goodness.
Remember
stop
that?
It. No,
well,
I don't.
Well, George was right. Not about really anything he did 1978 on, but he was right that they were just going to hump this thing until it was dust.
Yeah.
And they did. That's and it became
true.
Dust way faster than they thought it was going to.
Oh, yeah. I liked that we had Poe, Finn, and Rey working together on a quest. But I just feel like the drama was fabricated and like it quickly went away.
Fabricated?
Fabricated.
Fabricated is, they sell those at Pier 1.
Wow. But I don't know. I think, like, I was surprised to see Han Solo in this, but I don't think it was misplaced.
No.
Really?
No.
You weren't surprised?
No.
Oh. Okay.
You could do something like, oh, we have to blow up a big round planet that blows up other planets. You could do that and people go, you can't be sorry. Here's the deal. Here's the thing. I can't tell the difference anymore between things that are supposed to be homages or like references and things that just happen in a Star Wars movie.
Sure.
People said that, well, he kind of remade or soft rebooted Star Wars, A New Hope for Force Awakens, which you're complaining, but you also agree that that's a pretty good move to get
right.
a new generation into this.
Yeah.
And then you get to... I spend so little time thinking about Last Jedi, I don't even know what people think. But then you get to this and people are complaining about that. And I'm like, look at every single movie in this 9-movie series. I've got a bad feeling about this. We've got to fly into a thing that's bigger than our ship or whatever. You got to go through asteroids. That's all this series has ever done.
Mm-hmm.
So it's doing it self-consciously in this film because it's trying to... like James Bond, Spectre was the 50th anniversary, right?
I think so.
So there's all these like, oh, it's the original car. Oh, remember when he shot a guy with a spear gun in Thunderball or whatever? Now they're doing it on purpose. So maybe they kind of get off the hook or maybe they did it too much. I don't know. I can never tell anymore if it's copying or homaging or what.
Right.
So I just feel like that criticism is invalid. Now, if there are completely ridiculous... hand-wavy constructions in the plot just to move things forward, that's not good.
Right.
Like, if you go, well, let's see, how did we get onto a ship in Star Wars? Well, they captured us and tractored us in, but then we kind of messed with them and were able to, like...
escape somehow.
Infiltrate and then get back out due to the great cost and sacrifice of one character.
Right.
Or Power Ranger gives us a literal, it should just say plot on the token that she gives them. That allows them to get on the ship, and it's supposed to, it's the leader, it's Snoke's, Supreme Leader Snoke's Star Destroyer, and then his waltz in and out of it.
Right.
I mean, that's you know, cutting corners.
Yeah, I hear what you're saying.
There's so many corners cut here. Poot's got nowhere to sell drugs. Wire reference. I don't know. And you see that a lot. And then it's like, well, there's a million Star Destroyers, but they need this radar to work, so we're going to attack the radar. But no, don't, the radar's not important because now it's on the ship.
Yeah,
so now we're going to... Somebody had the idea, we're going to ride horses on a ship. Because remember, the Ewoks beat the Empire with logs because it's your heart and not your technology that gets it done.
Right.
And so this devastated rebellion with these 50-year-old ships is going to... How do we have them ride horses into battle? That's a good image.
Right.
There's a bunch of ships. It's all just writing backwards to create these moments that honestly weren't super amazing moments.
Yeah. I hear you. And like we get these new characters, but I just feel like it's so jam-packed with all this stuff. We don't really spend that much time with them.
Wait, what new characters did we get?
Well, Carrie Russell's character who
Oh, plot device?
Yeah.
With a apostrophe in the last name.
Yeah, and we see her eyes, but she doesn't really take her mask off the entire time. And her and Poe kind of have this like
if I know
are we gonna
Pedro
get together
Pascal
or not?
Technique at all.
Yeah.
Was she actually in the film?
I think she was. Okay. But yeah, and then we meet I can't remember the actress's name, but we meet a bunch of people who
it's another Z. It's like Zana or something like
yeah,
that.
Yeah, who like were stormtroopers, but they like defected. So
and at this point, I don't know if we are just literally putting little dabs of color in the margins or if it's all set up for extended content now. Because you can always do that, right?
Yeah.
Like, Palpatine is dead. If they had Zalpatine or Frank Grimes or just... Like, if there had been some new Sith Lord, you would have gone, oh, they'd pull some weird Sith Lord out of their ass. But then, over the next 50 years, somebody would write a bunch of books and comics about Dark Lord Frank Grimes, right?
Yeah.
But instead, we used Palpatine, and so now, same thing's going to happen. And if you've got... a former stormtrooper Z2-109 or whatever. Now we're going to get a ton of stories about her. Now,
yes.
I'm not going to read them, so it would have been really interesting if I had seen anything about her character on this screen. But at this point, it's just too much. We're 2.5 hours in and there's just way too much.
Yeah.
And I actually kind of wanted to see her story. Like the idea that maybe Finn slaying the giant Phasma or whatever inspired a lot of stormtroopers to be like,
Let's go.
But it's literally just mentioned, and it's not the kind of thing. It's not the kind of thing. It's not the kind of margin detail from the original Star Wars where you went, "Huh, what's that gunk droid's kind of weird," and then some mother effer goes and writes an entire book about gunk droids or something, or at least a full Wikipedia page. I really didn't care that much.
Right.
I'm not sure if it's good or bad that they are now prompting that sort of thing. So if you like, I don't like her enough to know her name, but if you like Zana or Zara or whatever her name is, you're in luck because there will be a comic in the future.
Sure.
I don't know if that's good or bad.
I know.
It's almost impossible to rate this or evaluate it as a film. It is just, it is just the next, it's a product line, you know?
Yeah.
It is the 2019 you know, spring fashion walk or something like that. And here are all the new looks.
Right.
You get something like at the end with like land, people are thinking this is a weird moment. I thought it was a cool moment. I was just really sad that we'll never know because she meets Lando.
Yes.
He's like, hey, where are you from? And she's like, I don't know. And he's like, let's find out. Like that was just really great and hopeful.
I thought so too.
But I'm never going to find out. So.
Right. I know.
General Pride. How much money do you need?
For what?
Richard Grant?
No.
Enough to be in a Star Wars movie and your character's name is General Pride.
That's horrible.
Well, you know, he got the job when Admiral Grumpy got killed.
Oh, my goodness. okay, and then, like, Hux being revealed to be the spy, it is so short-lived.
Screw that guy.
Okay,
the actor and the character. Who cares?
I just thought they could have done
the
more
first
with
scene
it.
Could have been... Please let me out of here. And then, like, we just see his skull pop as he's crushed in a garbage compactor.
Wow.
And we just move on.
Okay.
Who cares?
All right. you are not a fan.
No. But that's it. They sold out that character in the second movie, so you had to bring General Grief Pain or whatever his name is in.
Yeah.
Because you just don't even believe in that character anymore.
It was true.
That's the one thing that, look, what you like or hate what Rian Johnson did, so there are some things that you can say conclusively you shouldn't have done. And one was kill off Phasma.
Yeah.
Because not that she and Finn need to have a 3-movie arc, but have some bad guy besides
Hux.
Hux, and also the bad guy that is clearly going to be a good guy eventually, Kylo Ren.
Right.
Have
right.
somebody down there.
Right.
And they just made him into a complete joke mm-hmm. in a lot of not funny scenes. Do we talk about how, like, Oscar Isaac is just not, he's like a character. It's like a portal opened up. Thanos opened a portal in the MCU.
Yeah.
And a guy fell through who was like a pilot. And then he was an Air Force pilot. And then he learned to pilot X-Wings and he became Poe Dameron.
Yeah,
he's like
yeah.
not taking any of this seriously, but not in a get this walking carpet out of my way kind of way. Like,
right.
boy, is this a Star Wars? What a Star Wars this is. I'm in a Star Wars. I don't know if I like this Star Wars that I'm in. He just keeps like popping a hole in the ostentatiousness that kind of needs to be in Star Wars a little bit. There are yeah. knights in space.
Right, right.
I just, it's going to be garbage for hours if we don't try to, there's just nothing to say.
Okay, fair.
And by that I mean there is everything to say.
Well, I mean, do you think that they did like the Evil Ray just for so they could have more merchandising options?
You think they're going to sell an Evil Ray figure? I mean, yeah. Star Wars Black series definitely will, but you think yeah. you think little girls are going to be playing with an Evil Ray figure?
Really, I don't see why not.
Just like the little boys used to play with the Darth Vader figure where the mask is broken off and there's a Luke head inside.
Okay, all right.
No, maybe it's just a reference to that.
Okay, I see. Yeah.
I mean, I hate for our review of the last Star Wars movie to be kind of a flame out, but the movie's a flame out. Now, that being said, I enjoyed it and I think I'm going to go again.
Okay.
I thought it was a really non-offensive way to do something that it's not fair, you don't deserve to get this job, but to find a way to wrap up this entire series after the creator of the series did his best to ruin it with 3 movies. And if he, to be believed, if, you know, kind of almost ruined it in the first 3 movies.
Right.
And then money-grubbing Disney came around.
I know.
A mouse with dollar signs in their eyes is like, make more! And then you had to somehow wrap it up in a way that, like you said, was fun and positive. And I think they nailed that. And I enjoyed the movie. But
yeah.
I don't ever really want to think about it ever again.
Well, I just have a question for you.
Sure.
I
love Fortnite.
Okay. When Kylo Ren or Ben shows up with Palpatine and Rey is there, Palpatine says something about like, ooh, the last Skywalker, blah, blah, blah. And he like throws him in a pit and then he comes back up.
I don't think that you should introduce something, a dyad, 15 minutes from the end of the movie.
Okay, what do you mean by that?
That's something that he says in the movie and apparently comes from Rebels or something like that. The idea of two Force users having a connection.
Oh,
and we've seen this play out
over
the films in what I think is probably one of the best new additions to the Force canon,
yes.
like the idea that these guys,
that they
and then they get a little,
other.
I mean, it's a movie. They get a little movie with it where it's like, now we can like trade things back and forth. Like, hey, here's, oh man, that looks good. Give me some of that juice.
Right.
Oh, thanks for the juice. Like, just like, I don't know how that works.
No, I don't either.
But yeah, that was kind of neat. And like I said, that comes from a cartoon. And then the Emperor just says, a dyad. And then later on, all the Jedi are behind her and they're trying to get her up.
Yeah.
And you're hearing like all these voices. I have no clue who these people are. And I guess it's cool that like the actress who plays Ahsoka Tano on Clone Wars got to be in a Star Wars movie. But
right.
I don't know who any of these people are.
Yeah, I hear what you're saying.
So sorry, continue.
My question is, he's Han Solo and Leia Skywalker's kid.
Yeah.
Wouldn't his last name be Solo, or would it be hyphenated? Would it be Solo Skywalker or Skywalker Solo?
That's up to the Skywalker Solos.
Yeah. So I just was curious about that. Also, I like that he gives his life force to Rey, but I don't like that he like immediately dies thereafter. That bothered me. Like, why can't we have this character who was bad turn good and not die? Like, why does he have to die like his grandfather
Darth
did?
Darth Vader.
I know.
That's why? Yeah.
It makes me so mad.
You know what makes me mad?
Hmm.
the one thing that any dumb movie can do, I'll bring the Fast and Furious back, is fight. You just get Ray Park or the clones that they made of Ray Park.
Sure.
And have some good fighting. And
yeah.
There's no good lightsaber scenes in this.
I would agree with you. And we should have gotten... They're all
shot from like a medium sort of shot angle. And you see a lot of heads and shoulders and like blades coming in and out of the thing. But clearly you did choreography.
Right.
So why not just pull back and show it to us?
Yeah.
I feel like J.J. Abrams' movies... I don't know if he does the action. I think he hands it off to somebody because I feel like a lot of his films are people breathlessly and cleverly talking to each other in a room. Then they run out of that room and probably get involved in something.
Mm-hmm.
Then they reach the next room. And everything feels like cut scenes in a video game.
Sure.
You know, or yeah. Now we're in a medium-sized room and we're talking about something. Then we walk out into a big area and that's where the fight is. And then mm-hmm. we go to another thing.
Yeah.
And you get that in some of the locations, which I liked when they go to the Christmas Village. Like, I liked the Christmas Village.
Mm-hmm.
But everything just sort of takes place on, like, one set, one street. And they're all talking about him being a Spicer or whatever. Sean Spicer.
Yeah.
And then we go to – then we just go to the next location, which is Babu Frick's basement. And basically just stay there.
Yes.
Until we go to, like, another thing. Like, there's just no sense of... It all feels like sets. It all feels... Even though it's just amazing design. I mean, this movie is beautiful. It's great
mm-hmm.
looking.
Mm-hmm.
But it just doesn't feel... It doesn't feel real to me.
I know.
This space movie with lasers and giant snakes.
And I was just thinking while you were saying that, like, the Knights of Ren, we should have had a huge fight with them.
Huge flame out. I know.
And, like, they should have been, like, really powerful, and it should have been a huge... Well, it should have been a struggle for Kylo Ren to beat all of them
at once. He trained them all.
Yeah,
Maybe he trained them all with Bobo moves. So he's like, I know I'll have to take you out someday, so you're gonna... Oh, no, the best thing to do is, like, turn around and, like... Hide if you hide your face will strike.
I don't know.
Always put your weapon down and bow to your opponent. And
well, I mean, if we had seen any of that beforehand, that would have.
But maybe there's just maybe they don't have anybody because I admit, like the lightsaber fights in the prequels are excessive.
Oh my god, the one with Yoda and what's his name?
But they worked on him though.
Yeah, I know.
And they don't have that guy, I don't think, because Force Awakens. Has that climactic lightsaber fight in the forest, which is great.
Yes.
And then Last Jedi has the one scene that everybody talks about, the throne room scene, which I think everybody agrees from a story perspective is ridiculous. Like, your boss is dead and the ship's blowing up. You're like, all right, see ya. But I guess they're all fanatically dedicated to this puppet that Palpatine made in a jar?
Apparently.
Anyway.
Yeah.
But then you can go through... And, like, see videos on YouTube where they go, look at this. This doesn't make any sense. Like, all the choreography in that scene is terrible.
Mm.
And they got that same guy, or they just went, let's just shoot around, like, his terrible choreography for this film. Because there's just no good stuff. There's that one climactic fight. It's not even a climax, because there's another 45 minutes left, where they're fighting on the Death Star piece. That's probably the best fight.
Yeah, probably.
But even as they're fighting, I don't understand what's happening. Because as they fight... The enthusiasm between the two of them seems to be less and less. And that makes sense from a character perspective because he's so conflicted at this point.
Yeah.
She is worried. She's afraid to use her full strength because she feels like she'll become evil if she does.
Yes.
And so neither of them are really going all the way.
Right.
Until they just sort of like collapse and kind of end the fight.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, she does like viciously like stab him when she gets the opportunity, which is like, maybe you are evil. But that's not a good... emotional stab, so to speak, for a climactic fight. Imagine the Princess Bride and the Spaniard and the Dread Pirate Roberts.
Yeah.
Neither of them really want a fence.
Yeah, yeah.
And then they're
yeah.
just fencing. Oh, I'm not really left handed. I mean, sometimes I just pretend to be left handed. Okay. Okay, great. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah. I know. And then as soon as she has wounded him, she heals him. My name is Inigo Montoya.
You mildly inconvenienced my father.
Yeah, it's not the same.
Prepare to be accosted for several minutes.
Well, something else that bothered me is so Finn is like, they have Chewie. He's in this cruiser or whatever. And she's trying really hard to get it to stay. And then Kylo Ren is also fighting with it, getting it to move.
X-Men Dark Phoenix.
Yeah, I know. And remember then,
how,
like,
we all complained about how dumb everybody looked just with their hands
just
out?
Just putting their hands
same
out?
Same thing.
Yeah. And then she, like, electrocutes it, and everybody on board dies. She thinks that Chewie's dead. We find out later Chewie is not dead.
Right. We don't care about...
But she killed people.
Yeah, but all the stormtroopers are not people. We've already established that. Right, Finn?
Oh, my goodness.
One more thing. Why all the flashing lights? Like, when I heard that there was going to be an epilepsy warning, I thought...
Oh, boy.
In 2019, and then it turns out it's
lightning.
Just to hide the bad makeup on Palpatine. There's ways to make him look scary that have nothing to do with just randomly flashing lights.
Yeah, no, I agree.
So I don't know. However you feel about this movie depends on what you thought of the last movie. I think if you thought that the Return of the or the Last Jedi was like a bold new direction, even though I'd argue Ryan knocked over all the toys and gave us nowhere to go. I mean, mm-hmm. is Broom Boy going to be the star of episode 9?
Oh,
I don't
goodness.
Think so. Then you probably hate this. And if you think that Last Jedi was needlessly disruptive and just against the spirit of where we're going here, then you probably like that this kind of got things back on track.
Yeah.
But,
I mean,
you're both wrong. And I'm thinking about this. The whole thing about Oscar Isaac being like, no.
Yeah.
What? First of all, come on, buddy. You're still on, under contract, right?
I know, right?
But, like, what an FU that is to Disney, who, I'm not saying that they were thought this through, but we're probably thinking they had another MCU on their hands here.
Probably.
Because Chris Evans shows up. He's been here for 10 years. He keeps, he's in Thor just to, like, play Loki playing him. You know what I mean? Like,
yes.
He shows up for stuff. They probably thought... This is great. We don't have any time pressure. We've got these new hot actors, interesting characters. We're going to go forever with this. And three movies in, they're like, we are never coming back.
I know.
Play the Taylor Swift song. Let's do this.
I know.
And they must be like, we are screwed. Now what?
Right.
Now we got to get these two racist guys to come up with a whole new trilogy.
I know.
I love the movie.
They're not doing it anymore.
Go see it. It's great.
Yeah.
Definitely go see it.
Yeah.
It's really good.
Yeah.
I mean, it's not great, but it's good.
I think it's good. And I mean, I think...
No, that was my... You already said it was good. That was mine.
Okay.
You're done.
I just think it's interesting. You compare the MCU actors to the Star Wars actors, and the MCU actors are like, I could do this forever.
They're so gracious. They're so sad to leave, but they've got crappy romantic comedies to make.
Right.
Or Doolittle.
Right. And then, like, the...
There was nine previews ahead of Star Wars.
Oh, my God.
We don't live that Stubbs life, but we did go to AMC.
Yes.
And there was a half an hour of previews.
Easily.
Yeah.
It was too much.
Come
it was
on,
overkill.
Stubbs. I'd like to... Those would be Stubbs.
Yeah, exactly.
Shorter.
But, yeah, I enjoyed it, and I would recommend it. I think largely because the ending was so positive and it ended on a high note, and I think these characters are going to... You can tell they are going to move on and continue to fight the good fight if they need to.
In comic books.
But, yeah.
Right. In books.
Exactly.
And not on the screen.
Right.
They had a bad feeling about this. And they were right. Well, I don't know. I'm sure that we'll talk about it in the future as the weeks go. Or maybe not. Maybe we'll just never say anything else about it ever again.
About Star Wars?
It's kind of feeling that way right now. But
yeah,
I know that there's a lot I didn't say because it's just serves no purpose other than me just... It's like pooping. It's like evacuating.
Yeah.
And I mean, I don't think that's really entertainment. So anyway, tell us what you thought because people have thoughts.
Oh, yes.
Everybody's had. There's the one thing you can say is that this is something that I don't think anybody can not have an opinion on.
I agree with you. Yeah.
So
you have to come down.
Let us know yours on social media, Facebook and Twitter. Also, we're coming up at the end of the year here.
Yep.
And the best gift that you could give us would be a review on iTunes.
Absolutely.
Or your listing platform of choice.
Mm-hmm.
We really need those for, just prospective listeners or even, the computer overlords to know that we're doing a good job. So
yes.
Give us a review. Give us a rating. Give us 5 extra lightsabers.
Sure.
Because there's another one floating around.
Yeah.
And you know what? 2 a lot better than one.
Right.
Right? That's the kind of thinking that J.J. Abrams has, a man who knows nothing about Star Wars, even though he really likes it, I guess.
Right.
But yeah, get two on there.
Yes.
Or maybe just five. Five stars to War Within. Yes. That is it for us for this week. We'll be back for an end of the year show talking about our favorite stuff from 2019. And I'm going to do it. I'm going to talk Mika into watching The Witcher and have a little mini review of The Witcher.
Okay.
So stay tuned for that. And that's it. Have a Merry Christmas and a Happy Holidays.
Merry Christmas.
From all of us here at Just Enough Trope. I hope my gift is interferons.
What is
to
that?
Get rid of this sickness that I've struggled through.
Okay.
This entire show, but
you've done a really good job.
Thank you. We're still doing it here, and we'll continue to do it in 2020. And we're signing off. I'm your host, Caliban.
I'm your co-host, Mikan Hanna.
Keep the geek fires burning.